Our next contestant, and possibly final contestant in the speech contest this year, is Stephen Dance from South West England, South Wales, with his speech entitled The Gift of the Gar. With their speech, The Gift of the Gar, can you please welcome Stephen Dance?
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, you are about to witness a speech the like of which has never been seen at a national conference. Indeed, I believe that no one throughout the entire history of the ASC will have witnessed a speech like the one I am proposing to deliver. A dramatic claim indeed, but one I make with complete confidence. Yet, it has nothing to do with what I'm going to say. Nor have I said it. Nothing to do with dynamic gestures or imponderably long pauses. No, my speech will be radically different from any other that you've seen before because I am proposing to take my clothes off one by one and to deliver this speech completely and utterly. Naked. And why not? Why not? I've got nothing to hide, nothing to be ashamed of. Or maybe a few things, but it's not that. Look, if Jamie Oliver can find fame and fortune as the naked chef, then why should I, Stephen Dance, not find fame and fortune as the naked solicitor? Actually, many of my clients are the naked officer in the bill. So for those of you who think I'm joking, think again, because here goes. Oh dear, would you believe it? I practiced this speech at home in front of a mirror, which incidentally cracked. But I've completely overlooked the fact that if I disrobe here, I've got nowhere to stick this microphone. Any suggestions? Keep to yourself. I'm so sorry. I'll have to carry on as I am, completely garbed. So you either have to use your imagination, or instead admire my sartorial splendor. Now some of you look very relieved. Others I can see are bitterly disappointed. But what most of you seem to have is a look of shock, which is perfectly understandable. Because it's not very often you see a lawyer without his briefs. However, my real reason for wishing to do this talk au naturel was to comment on how we are judged by people. We are judged on our height, our accent, our job, our age, and our hairs, and often by our appearance. Not just how we look, but by our clothes. And people will often form a firm opinion after a few seconds of just eyeing you up and down. For example, when I walked onto the stage today, how many of you wondered why I was wearing such a bright yellow tie? Now, yellow has conflicting associations. It's the colour of sunshine, it's the colour of hope, it's the colour of happiness, redolent of a host of golden daffodils or a field of wheat flowing gently in a summer breeze. Conversely, it's the colour of bile and jaundice and can represent deceit and cowardice. On the other hand, given the impending election, maybe you thought I was a member of the Liberal Democratic Party or even the little-known Custard Appreciation Society. As it happens, I'm a divorce lawyer. I'm often involved in custody battles. The mundane truth, sadly, is that this is the only tie I have which does not have ketchup or gravy stains. Now, many people see a fashion sense as a great gift, the gift of the god, but when we make snap judgments, it's too easy to cruelly castigate those who make fashion go faux pas. And it's far worse if you're a public figure. Gordon Brown, as Chancellor of the Exchequer, was maliciously maligned for wearing a lounsuit at a black tie dinner at the Bank of England. Michael Foote, the ex-Labour leader, excruciatingly excoriated for wearing a duffel coat at a Remembrance Day service at the cenotaph. And David Beckham, mercilessly mocked for admitting to wearing a sarong and occasionally his wife's underwear. And of course, women suffer far more than the men. Just think of the vitriol heaped upon so many actresses and female politicians. It's ubiquitous and iniquitous. But clothes, clearly, are very important in specific situations. The policeman's uniform, the priest's robes, the judge's gown and wig. Clothes can define you and set you apart from others, but that is no reason to be judgmental on those who cannot afford to shop in Armani or Gucci or keep up to date with the latest fashions and trends. As you know, beauty is only skin deep, and clothes can cover up a multitude of sins. Just reflect on those invidious investment bankers in their sleek, shiny silk $5,000 suits who nearly ruined the economy many years ago. Surely there's more to life than pointlessly pontificating on what clothes to buy and wear. The fashion industry can be pernicious and persuasive. And for the gullible who are induced to part with their money, as assiduous acolytes of fashion, they are like sheep. Sheep who've had the wool put over their eyes with the result that they barely know what they are doing. Mark Twain noted that great things are not achieved by those who yield to fads and public popular opinion. So I think we should reflect on the wisdom of Albert Einstein. He was at home one day working when the German ambassador unexpectedly arrived to see him. Einstein's wife said to him, "You should change your clothes." But Einstein said, "I am here. If the ambassador wants to see me, I'm here. If he wants to see my clothes, open my closet and show him my suits." So we should follow his excellent example and judge people on what they say and what they do, and not on what they wear. So ladies and gentlemen, in retaining my clothes tonight, I have also retained my dignity. I have spared your blushes. And for those of you earlier who used your imagination, hopefully not put you off the meat and two veg at the dinner tonight.